Welcome to Hollywood United Methodist Church. We're glad you have joined us for worship on this first Sunday of February, which is a communion Sunday. So be sure to grab a piece of bread or a cracker, some juice, perhaps a donut and coffee, and be prepared to celebrate the Feast of Holy Communion with us at the end of the service. For now, let us join our hearts and our hands together as we worship God.
It never runs out on me.
Your love
never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love.
Your love
never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me.
Your love
never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Never runs out on me, your love.
In the silence of our hearts or in spoken words, let us give thanks for the gift of this day and pray for the life of the world. God, our Creator, thank you for the gift of Jesus. He walked among us embodying your creative and life-giving word in his body, his life, his words, his deeds, his sufferings, his death, and his resurrection. When we see him loving the outcast, forgiving the sinner, confronting the hypocrite, and teaching the crowds a new way of life, we see your heart, your compassion, your mercy, your character. To know Jesus is to love him, and to love him is to know him, and to know and love him is to know and love you. So help us, Lord, to be among your disciples who come to you to be taught. Help us, Lord, to be among the poor in spirit, to see and know that your kingdom is our homeland even now. Help us, Lord, to be among those who mourn, to join you in your sadness for all that's wrong and broken in this world, and in joining you to find true comfort. Help us, Lord, to be among the meek, those who find strength in weakness and power in vulnerability, to never fear lack or want. Help us, Lord, to desire justice, rightness, goodness, fairness, cleanness, clearness, and integrity more than we hunger for food or thirst for water. Help us, Lord, to be among the merciful. Help us to be a true friend to those who are hated, misunderstood, rejected, excluded, disregarded. When others fail, when they fail us, help us show the same mercy you show to those who fail you. Help us, Lord, to be among the pure in heart. May your pure light shine in our hearts and dispel every shadow, every layer, and fold that conceals or pretends. Help us to remove from our hearts everything that keeps us from seeing you. Help us, Lord, to be among the makers of peace. Many build walls. Many sow fear and distrust. Many spread rumors. Many inflame conflict and profit from it. Help us to be even among them an agent and messenger of your peace and reconciliation. Help us, Lord, not to fear being among the persecuted, but rather to rejoice in having the honor of standing for your restorative justice and rightness. Help us, Lord, to be among those who suffer wrong well and with grace. Help us not to resent it, not to fear it, not to seek to escape it. Instead, help us to find joy in it. When others insult us, make our lives more difficult, or falsely malign us because of you. So help us, Lord, to be among your disciples who come to you to be taught. We are limping, broken sinners and beginners, far from these realities, but this is where we want to go. In your mercy, lead us in this path. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for this online worship opportunity. I hope you will avail yourself of other opportunities that are online for fellowship and for study. You can find those on our Facebook page, on our website, or you can click on the link in the chat right now. Couple things to keep in mind in the week ahead. Ash Wednesday is February 17th. Beginning that day, we will have a daily devotion written by one of our congregation members. So be sure to put something in your calendar every day to remind you to check that devotion as a time of prayer and study and reflection during this very introspective season. Also, we will have a service that evening online at 7:30 p.m. But in preparation for the entire season of Lent, I encourage you, if you haven't already, sign up for Lent in a Bag. We would like to be able to deliver that Lent in a Bag to you prior to Ash Wednesday, so do it today. Finally, we have 5 Girl Scouts in our congregation, and typically they will sell after worship. That can't happen this year, obviously, but they are online. You can go to their online virtual store, and you can buy cookies for yourself to be delivered to you, or you can buy cookies for the Hollywood Food Coalition, housed right now in Grant Hall in our main kitchen, and they will deliver them to Grant Hall, to the Hollywood Food Coalition, which will go towards making some of the lunches and the dinners that are being prepared daily for folks in our community. So Support our local Girl Scouts and do some good today as well. All that we do here is made possible by you, by your prayers, your presence, your service, your witness, and your financial gifts. So I encourage you to continue to give as generously as you are able so that we might continue to both maintain our online presence, but increase the effectiveness of our ministries here in the heart of Hollywood and in Toluca Lake.
Decisions were announced on you. A reading from Mark 2, 1 through 12. Jesus heals a paralytic. When he returned to Capernaum after some days, it reported that he was at home. So many gathered around that there was no longer room for them, not even in front of the door. And he was speaking the word to them. And then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And having dug through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak in this way? It is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" At once Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions amongst themselves. And he said to them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, 'You are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up, take your mat, and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." Herein ends the reading.
Hey, everybody. It's good to share the message with you on this day as we continue our current sermon series, Forgive. And this morning's focus, well, it's a doozy. Forgive. The church. Raise your hands if you've experienced church hurt. Some of you may be raising both hands, like me. While I'm unable to see the hand raising from all of you, I'd say we're pretty close to or right at 100% those who have been hurt by the church. Okay, now let me ask this in a different way, but no raising of the hands this time. Has anyone experienced church hurt because of you? That heart-wrenching question may have given you pause, and you might need to reflect upon that more. Now, I'm going to admit in answering that question, humbling myself before you, I've caused church hurt. And the wearing of many church hats over the years, and now as the assigned lay pastor at Harmony Toluca Lake, I've unfortunately hurt others by my words, by my actions, intentionally and not intentionally. And by doing so, I've had to ask for forgiveness from others and from God. And I will continue to do so when I miss the mark, so that I make room for the Redeemer's grace to enter into my heart and to better direct my imperfect life. No matter how one slices it, forgiving the church as well as the need for forgiveness within the church, it's extremely challenging. It's not easy at all. It's complex and so complicated, especially when the church has been the source of your hurt and pain. We well know those wounds cut even deeper. For who anticipates being wounded by God's people? We look to the church to lead us and shepherd us, right? We trust the faith community and its leaders with our hearts. We make ourselves vulnerable so we can learn how to imitate Christ, like the Apostle Paul wrote to the Ephesians. And the complication is magnified when we have to differentiate between the source of our anguish being the church due to its restrictive policies and traditions against the rejection we felt caused by individuals within the church, which comes by way of clergy and other congregants. It's difficult at times to separate the actions of a few persons from the actions of the church universal. And to add further to this, it's difficult because the church seldom asks us for forgiveness. Lord have mercy. The issues of the universal church for which it needs forgiveness is long. For example, we're still dealing with racial issues in which faith communities deny that the dignity and sanctity of black life is a part of the DNA of this country. Truth is, the church has never been an innocent bystander in the history of white supremacy. In case in point, two good friends of mine who are clergy in the United Methodist Church in Texas have gone through the ringer because of their affirmative stance that black lives matter. For both, congregational members have left. One estimated 60 folks, the other around 80, because these white pastors took such a position. And they've both received hate mail and cut you to the core messages from church leaders and congregants. You see, church hurt also happens to clergy. Hollywood UMC had its own racial divide long ago. And it's important. This is important. We not forget that part of our church history. The first person who greeted me when I entered through the doors at Hollywood in the fall of 1986 was Leon Hawkins, the lead usher, just like our beloved Tim Bodler has been for many years. And this gregarious African-American male who was in his 80s treated me like I was one of his own family members. Over the time, Leon, oh gosh, he'd share numerous stories. He was a great storyteller, and he was one of the most loving human beings I've ever met. But there was one particular story that stood out, telling me about the time he and his late wife, Susie, had been invited by the senior pastor to attend the church. And this was when Hollywood UMC was an all-white church. We're talking 1950. Well, Leon and Susie, they didn't get the kind of warm reception I received when I first visited the church. Instead, they were given the cold shoulder and completely ignored by the congregation. Well, Leon said, "Mark, we didn't want to go back. Why would we go back to a white church that didn't want us?" And yet he continued by saying, "When the pastor called and asked us how our visit went, we told him." Well, he not only apologized, the man came by our home, spoke with us, asked for our forgiveness, and told us that if we were willing to return, our next church experience would be different. Leon said they prayed together and extended their forgiveness. It was then he and Susie decided to give the church another shot. And though it was far from perfect upon their return, the Hawkins were soon welcomed and fully embraced, and they became one of the stalwarts of Hollywood UMC as beloved members of the faith community, paving the way for racial diversity within the church. And it was Leon, prior to his death in the early 1990s, who was one of the key votes to push forward Hollywood UMC to become a reconciling, inclusive, and affirming congregation. Speaking of which, our own United Methodist Church denomination needs to ask for forgiveness and make amends for its maintained stance that the practice of homosexuality is incompatible with Christian teaching, that pastors may not be self-avowed practicing homosexuals, and may not conduct ceremonies that celebrate same-sex weddings or unions. While Hollywood UMC strongly advocates for the inclusion of LGBTQ+ Christians in all aspects of church life, and that includes the California Pacific Annual Conference, of which we're a part, and the Western jurisdiction of the United Methodist Church, and we celebrate that we're blessed with Associate Pastor Rev. Denyse Barnes and Pastor Emeritus Rev. Dr. Ed Hansen, it's still not enough. Even when the time comes when the next UMC General Conference is held, for which I'm a voting delegate, when we decide to either reorganize the structure of the denomination to affirm all persons, or we choose to separate to form new expressions of Methodism, the church must own the hurt it has caused. And the church must enter fully, with accountability for forgiveness. Thereby, healing and reconciliation can occur. Now, like I mentioned earlier, the issues of the universal church for which it needs forgiveness is long, and there are so many examples. However, here's the bottom line. Whether we feel pain due to it coming from individuals within the church or from policies, traditions of the church, The pain we have experienced is real. There are countless ways in which we've all been wounded. And layer that with what hurts one of us hurts all of us. Some of you have been rejected by your home church because of who you are or for whom you love. Some of you have been told by pastors and church leaders, you're not good enough, that you aren't part of God's good creation, that the Eternal One's judgment has rained down upon you because of your divorce, or that your spouse's abuse is your fault, or that you're going to hell because you associate with those people, or that your struggles with depression or your fill-in-the-blank struggles are due to your lack of faith, or. Some have been rejected by church leaders who will put on a show and shout it from the street corner that they're sinners living by the grace and love of God. Nevertheless, when it comes to you, where is that offer of the same grace, the same love? How in the world can we forgive the church when it hurts so much? Isn't this the place where unconditional love is offered? Isn't this the place where the Holy One's amazing grace is in abundance? Isn't this the place where they say all are welcome? Friends, it's imperative that we have a culture of forgiveness in this church, our church, as well as in the church universal. But forgiveness within the church, it's often the hardest forgiveness to either offer or obtain for two reasons. One, in our mind's eye, we visualize, we want the church to be perfect. We have an assumption, it's an oasis of perfection and goodness. What we tend to forget, though, is this. The local church, its body of believers, is a collection of wounded persons and sinners seeking a place where they can discover wisdom, truth, grace, healing, and love. And as long as people are a part of it, the local church will never be perfect. Plus, like the body of believers within the church, all pastors are sinners, are wounded, and they're imperfect. Yep. All of us being together, it can get messy. Second reason, forgiveness is hard to obtain when the church itself, along with its leaders, may be more interested in power and security than for love and grace. And there is a whole litany of examples for that. It is in the power grab. The church has edged God out. Sort of like today's scripture passage from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. The church authorities, the legal experts, were far more interested in operating with power and security than under conditions of love, mercy, and grace. They wanted to dictate how persons in need might expect to receive God's mercy. They'd rather you stay paralyzed than to be released and set free of whatever burdens you might be carrying, rather than be healed. You see, the religious leaders were playing an economic game. And then there's Jesus threatening to blow it all up with forgiveness, not playing by their rules. And can you just imagine how they all get in Jesus' face? They're just muttering and griping away, to which the Lord basically replies, you say I have no right to forgive sins. You believe that if this man is ill, it's because he's a sinner. And you're saying he has to find his way to Jerusalem and give up what money he has, which only adds to his burdens, before he can be forgiven? It's only then he can be healed? Well, Jesus, don't play. Watch this. And then Jesus spoke the word and the man was healed. He was no longer paralyzed. And while forgiveness may not have cured the man of the paralysis of his body, what forgiveness did was, it healed the paralysis of his soul. His relationship connection with God was back on track, restored, and he was made whole with the community. Church hurt can definitely cause paralysis, damaging our souls. To be the body of Christ, though, as a healthy Christian faith community that wholeheartedly practices and lives into a culture of forgiveness, Jesus tells us over and over and over, practice forgiveness. Forgiveness must be, it has to be an integral part of the faith community. For it is in the heart of forgiveness there is grace. When we've been hurt by the church, friends, it's important we go first to the source of love, God. Spend time in prayer with the Holy One. As 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares about you. Second, after prayer, meet with the pastor or another leader in the church who can be objective and who you can trust. And for me, there even came a point when I needed guidance from a licensed counselor. By speaking with these trusted individuals, you are then moved into healing. And note, this isn't about getting retribution. It's about dealing with whatever pain or discord exists within the church body and dealing with whatever pain that has been caused and exists within you. Third, after prayer and meeting with the pastor or other church leader that you trust, be direct with the person who caused the hurt. And understand, they may not even know they hurt you. Come from a place of compassion and tell them how you've been hurt. And if that one-on-one doesn't work, then follow what Matthew 18 shares. By doing this, we follow Jesus rather than the world. What does the world say to do? Seek and destroy. Take it to social media. What does Jesus want us to do? Seek and reconcile. Fourth, forgive. That's a process. It may be a one day at a time process, as in, I forgave such and such yesterday, but I've woken up today and, whew, man, I need to forgive them again. And yeah, the process of forgiveness may take a while. It's work. Well, what if those in the church or the church itself refuses to acknowledge the hurt that it's caused? Well, Jesus didn't say, you know, it's okay to just love me and hate my people. Jesus said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. We are still called to love, and that includes the act of forgiveness. It's only in the forgiving that our aching wounds and searing pain of loss can be transformed. And lastly, sometimes healing comes from a church wound by finding a new faith community to attend. But if that's the case, which I know has been for some of you in your decision to be connected with the Hollywood UMC family, it's important to take your time. Allow the new church community to revive you, to support and care for you, to allow Christ's light to shine brightly and wash over you, to forgive. As Lewis Meads wrote in The Art of Forgiving, when we forgive, we bring in light where there was darkness. We summon positive to replace negatives. We open the door to an unseen future that our painful past had shut. When we forgive, we take God's hand, walk through the door, and stroll into the possibilities that wait for us to make them real. Friends, when we forgive the church, we commit ourselves to changing the church. As followers of Christ, may we be the change we want to see, with God leading the way, this day and always. Amen.
It was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he gathered his disciples together in the upper room. And it was there that Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke the bread. And he gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, all of you, for this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to God, and he gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and drink, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you will in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and wine. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be your hands and feet in this broken and hurting world. For all of the ways in which you bless us and give us life, grace, and forgiveness, we offer you thanks and praise this day in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we pray now the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The bread of life. The cup of salvation. Take and eat. Go forth now knowing that you are a grace-filled, forgiven people. Go now knowing that God loves you. Go now knowing that God's grace is always upon you. Go in peace. Amen.